Welcome to the Knife Junkie Podcast, your weekly dose of knife news and information about knives and knife collecting. Here's your hosts, Jim Person and Bob the Knife Junkie DeMarco.
Hello, fellow Knife Junkie, and welcome to episode number 53 of the Knife Junkie Podcast. I'm Jim, the Knife Newbie Person.
And I'm Bob DeMarco, the Knife Junkie. Welcome to the show.
Welcome to our midweek episode of the Knife Junkie Podcast. Thanks so much for being here with us. If you're wondering why we're here midweek, hey, we explained that last week, our midweek episode of the Knife Junkie Podcast, where we have a chance to dive more into new knives, knife drops, knife news, give Bob a chance to rant a little bit about some things going on, which, you know, hint, hint, wink, wink, may be coming up this episode. Just saying, don't know for sure, Bob, but I got a good feeling.
I love all these knives.
Hey, I want to do a little bit of blatant self-promotion here, if we will. Was looking online and through the emails. I can't remember where I saw it, but I saw Knife Magazine's November issue, kind of a sneak peek where they put out, and they've got the cover featuring a couple of Les George's knives.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, a couple of gorgeous ones. And the blatant self-promotion is I wanted to let listeners know that if they didn't hear it or haven't been with us that long, we had Les George back on episode number 17 of the Knife Junkie Podcast back in February. So definitely want to go back and check that one out.
Man, those knives get me excited. Les George is a former Marine. He was an EOD EOD guy and so started making knives for himself, and then that expanded. But he has an unabashed love for trench knives and daggers. I would say daggers chiefly, and that bleeds into trench knives. And man, is he producing some amazing, A, historical reproductions, but B, modern interpretations of the classic sort of Sykes Fairbairn commando knife and the 1918 trench knife. You know that one. That's the one with the big brass knuckle duster on it and the double-edged blade. I mean, could there be a cooler looking knife ever in history? And he is jamming these things out.
Yeah.
They are beautiful. And as a knife collector, and as someone who loves Les George's designs, I have a couple of them, none of his actual knives, but I have the ProTec Rockeye Switchblade, and I have the 0920 from ZT. His knives are just inherently beautiful, the ones that he just creates all on his own. But when he does these retellings of past blades, man, are they beautiful. And as a collector, I would love to have something he's created, even just for Spartan blades. He made a dagger for Spartan blades that's gorgeous. But man, if you're into daggers at all, or that 1918 trench knife, or anything with knuckle dusters on it, really check his stuff out, Les George. Amazing stuff.
Well, and you can hear that interview episode number 17 of the Knife Junkie Podcast. You'll find that at theknifejunkie.com. If you want to go directly to all the podcasts, you can go to theknifejunkie.com/listen. But if you just go to theknifejunkie.com, you'll find a drop down for podcasts where you can go to the archives, the current episodes, even subscribe to the Knife Junkie Podcast and the Knife Junkie newsletter. That's at theknifejunkie.com/subscribe. That way you can catch every new episode of our twice weekly show right on the website or your podcast player, however you like to listen to audio.
You're listening to the Knife Junkie Podcast. It's time now for the latest knife life news.
All right, Bob, one of the things that we definitely wanted to do when we started, still don't have a name for it, show number two or supplemental issue or whatever, our midweek episode.
Jim, I like to call it the Knife Junkie Supplemental, like on Star Trek. And I'm not a big Trekkie, but on the Star Trek The Next Generation, he did his captain's log. And then sometimes he had things to add to it, so he'd say captain's log, supplemental.
Okay. Maybe I'll get on board with that.
Okay.
The Knife Junkie Supplemental episode. One of the things we wanted to do was, of course, bring you knife life news. And a lot of knife news to talk about this week, Bob. I think we're going to cover James Brand, Steel Wheel, ZT, and Tops. Where do you want to start?
I want to start on a positive note.
Okay.
Let's start with the James Brand. So this is a company that I always, I'm going to be 100% honest here, that I always kind of derided internally as a hipster knife brand. Oh, that's a hipster knife. Even the name, the James Brand, that's so hipster sounding. And I realized that was coming out of a certain defensiveness only because their knife designs didn't resonate with me. I like bigger, more tactical knives. These, the knives James Brand creates are, I don't want to call them crossover knives. They're knives that appeal, that can appeal to everybody, like non-knife guys, non-knife girls. These are the people that we're trying to reach anyway.
Like and me.
Like you. And it occurs to me that if you want a pocket knife in every pocket in this country, it can't all be an Emerson. It can't all be a Topps knife. You know, some of them have to be for non-knife people because these are, what are they? They're utility tools. Mm-hmm. Everyone needs one. We've said that over and over. But not everyone is going to gravitate towards something big, mean, and tactical looking like I do. And this is where a company like the James brand really shines, I think. And this is mm-hmm. where their value is really evident. So they have a new knife that actually does resonate with me design-wise. It's quite beautiful. It's called the Duval. Interesting name, like Shelley or Robert, or I'm not sure. I actually did not do much research on this knife. I could have found that out where they came up with the name. But it's a front flipper, and it is a beautiful Warncliffe blade. It's so it's small. It's about 2.5 inches. It's S35VN, and it's got, they've taken sort of the rounded off sheep's foot profile and put a bit of an angle on it so you can do some piercing. And it's got a micarta handle, very neutral, very simple handle. And the overall profile of this thing is pretty darn nice. It doesn't have a pocket clip. It has a little lanyard post, so you can just kind of drop it in the bottom of your pocket and forget about it. Now, a little caveat, I cannot do that. I get really weird about my pockets, and usually that kind of knife ends up riding horizontally against, you know, perpendicular to my leg, if you will, and that bums me out. And if you're in New York City and they see that coming through your pocket, printing through your pocket, they could be jerks about it because they have laws on the books that allow them to be jerks about that. But that being said, I really think this this new Duval is pretty cool looking. Like I said, their baseline model has S35VN, but they have a propensity to dip into the Damasteels for their other knives like the Chapter. But this thing is light and beautiful and functional, and I don't know what it is, but it has something for me too in the design.
And you mentioned it's a flipper. It's their first front flipper.
Yeah, it's their first front, and I'm not sure if it's their first flipper period, but the front flipper, a relative newcomer to the scene, at least in the past, I don't know, 5 or so years. You know, it's one of those innovations that people are not quite sure if it ever needed to happen. It's just sort of, is it a novelty or is it an actual value added element to knives these days? And I can say from my metamorph, my real steel metamorph, that you can actually really mess up your palm of your hand if you're absent-mindedly fidgeting with a front flipper. Now, that's that front flipper. Apparently, the James brand has worked out the geometry of the front flipper to the bear, to the pivot, and apparently it works really well. And I'm sure it does. I'm sure, like anything else, it just takes in a little bit of practice. Plus, its size lends itself to the front flipper. I think the larger you get with a front flipper, the more likely you might be to poke your hand.
Right.
Or at least that's been my limited experience.
Right. Okay.
So I got to say, I'm interested in this knife. The blade is beautiful too. It's just a really nice profile.
All right. Well, moving on, more knife life news, if you will. We're going to talk about steel wheel. Steel wheel. Say that 3 times really fast.
Steel wheel.
And I'm going to let you pronounce the brand because I don't know how to pronounce it, but it's the newest budget oriented knife and steel wheels lineup.
Well, I think what the name implies, steel wheel, is that if you buy their knife, you have a will of steel. And I have a couple of their, I take it back. I have a cut jack, and I really like that knife. And I've been observing their output over the past couple of years, and they've come out with a lot of cool and interesting knives, things that might seem necessary for their lineup. But I got to say, this latest one, the Gina folder, is just, I don't know, man. It's a dog, I think. And okay, now I'm saying that against the opinions of people like Kevin Cleary, who's been on this show, and a couple of others who've who've reviewed this knife positively. Now, to me, the only good thing about this knife, just from looking at it, this is just an opinion from looking and reading about it, is that it's got a 3.9-inch blade. And you know I like the big blades. So that's a good thing. But man, how many more D2 G10 knives do we need from Steel Will? They obviously have the chops. They obviously have the designers and the manufacturers. I know they do a lot of their stuff in Italy. They can make some really fantastic knives. Why do they keep coming out with these generic kind of knives? Okay, it opens with a thumb stud. It's their first thumb stud only knife, I think, since the, for a while. Now the name of the pass blade is failing me. But the only USP, that's unique selling proposition of this knife, is the 3.9-inch blade and the thumb stud. Other than that, it's a wishy-washy design. It looks like it doesn't know what it wants to be. And I like Steel Will, and they're kicking butt, and I just want, you know, it's kind of a bummer when you see a company you like come out with a bummer knife. To me, it's just like, why bother with that? I have 15 other designs in my sketchbook that are 3.9 inches that would be a lot cooler.
Well, it's like what I think manufacturer suggested retail price, like a $75 knife. Is it kind of in that lower budget line that they don't have a lot in that they're trying to get the market for?
I would say that that's where they're growing the fastest. And to me, that area of knife is tricky. And for me, I either want to buy a knife for like under $50 or over $150. And that sounds so materialistic and stupid. I understand if you're listening to that and you hear that and you're like, But to me, like the knives in that in-between range, there are so many of them. And they're all kind of, and they vary from like really unnecessary to really excellent. I mean, there are a lot of Spyderco's that are in that range that are really excellent knives. And so to me, give me a 3.9-inch blade with D2 and G10 for under $50, and I'll be interested.
Is that possible?
Probably. I mean, they just have to, I don't know. I don't know, Jim.
Okay.
but to me, I look at this thing, and I'm just like, it's another Steel Will. Okay. Like, I can't imagine buying it, let alone collecting it and keeping it. But maybe that's me. Maybe I'm just grumpy today.
Yeah. Maybe next time you'll tell us how you really feel.
I love that. But let me say, you know, I love my Cutjack. I love the Modus. I love the, I keep forgetting what the name of their very first folder was. It was beautiful with it. That's what we want. My Carta. We want my Carta handles. We want really nice blades. Anyway.
Well, I can't remember one of the past guests on our episodes show, which comes out on Sundays, said, you know, they were making knives and they realized that the design and the look didn't resonate with everybody, but there was somebody out there that liked it. So, as you just mentioned, YouTube reviewer Kevin Cleary, who, by the way, was on episode number 32 of the Knife Junkie podcast, he talked highly about it. You're not so highly about it. Yeah. So, you know, there's a market for a lot of things for a lot of different people.
There is. And taste is subjective. And Kevin knows his knives, and he's handled many a knife, and probably all the Steel Wills, which I have not. So his opinion is, definitely more informed. Me, I'm just kind of flying off the cuff, and I looked at this, and I was like, why?
Why?
Do something cooler with all those resources.
All right. So maybe this next story will get you in a better mood. I don't know. ZT, discontinued sprint run of the ZT-0055?
Fat chance, Jim. Okay. So this is the airborne model. This is the ZT-0055, the production model ZT put out. Very nice knife. I have it. And actually, I've been trying to sell it only to fund something else. But it hasn't been selling.
Not in that $75 to $150 range.
Exactly. And it hasn't sold. And now I'm rediscovering how awesome it is. But anyway, ZT discontinued this model, and that's why I bought it in the first place. They discontinued it last year. It came out in 2017, discontinued it, I think, the beginning of 2019. And then I saw all of their retailers had it for, you know, rock bottom prices, $170. I was like, I got to get it. So I got myself one. Then they discontinued it, and then they do what they do. And I've noticed this with the 0920. And I think it's kind of cheap, I got to say, Jim. But what do I know? I don't own a big international knife company. Maybe this is what you have to do to make ends meet. But
not yet, you don't. Yeah.
No. Yeah, right. They released the 0055 like they did with the 920. Re-released it as a sprint run. So presumably they took the old ones that didn't sell and then coated them and made them look different. So this one now is the 0055. It's black. So it's the 0055 BLK model. And it's got a, you know, in ZT fashion, it's beautifully executed. It's all blacked out. And they put this goofy pattern on it. I don't know why they did that. They put some sort of a random geometric pattern on it. The whole thing is random geometry that works beautifully as a knife, you know, and it's milled and engraved in titanium. And here they decided that on top of the titanium, they have to put a decal. It's not a decal. I'm not sure what they did, anodized it in or something, but they had to put a graphic on the handle to make it look even more angular and weird looking. And to me, it's just an epic failure. It's lipstick on a pig. Not that this is a pig, but this is a discontinued knife. So to bring it back out and run it again and just dress it up in a different way and then charge, what are they charging? Like something crazy for it, $325 or something.
All right.
Yeah, $325. To me, that's just like, it's like with a rock band. You know, if you're going to go away gracefully after an awesome album and let that be that. Don't keep coming back with a new bassist and a new album and every 10 to 12 years, just say goodbye. Say goodbye. And the people who didn't get the 0055 can keep looking for them on the secondary market.
Right.
Instead of sullying the legacy of the knife with this goofy pattern.
Well, I got to admit, I'm looking at the handle design, as you called it, random geometric shapes or whatever. And I'm looking at it going, yeah, there's not like a design there to me that I see.
It brings no extra. I mean, I guess if that is your specific aesthetic or you really want the knife and you missed out on the good version, then you're going to buy this thing for $325. Mm. I think it's a cheap shot. Now, with the 920, when they discontinued that, that's the Les George, the big, beautiful flipper based on his custom knife, the Harpy. They discontinued that excellent knife and came out with two sprint runs that were actually cool looking. One of them had a blue handle, an anodized blue titanium handle, and a black DLC coated blade. Very fetching. And then the other model was a bronze handle, I believe, with a tiger stripe, sort of strider style tiger stripe blade. Arguably also cool. Not my aesthetic, but arguably also cool. So, but this one I think is a flop. You know, they took a knife that's so amazing looking and unique looking and just tried to add extra uniqueness to it. And
well, didn't work.
You know, ZT will always be near and dear to my heart, but lately, they've been pissing me off.
Hey, I wanted to ask you, you mentioned a couple of times sprint run. Mm-hmm. Being the knife newbie, I'm not sure I know what that means. Could you explain what sprint run means?
Well, a sprint run is a run of a knife that has different materials or a different execution than the usual version. And I always heard that term used with Spyderco. I thought, and I could be right or I could be mistaken, I thought that they coined that phrase, but I see that other people are using it, like ZT. So sprint run, say you have your average 0055 and it comes out in just titanium with a silvery looking blade, and that's that. And then they come out with this, and they make it black, and they put some diagrams on the side, and it's special and different. Also, I have to mention that it's an upgraded blade steel on this new sprint run. It's 20 CV up from S35VN. So that is another little value added bit.
Okay.
So they take an old knife, they take a regular knife and make it look not so regular, either with different materials like different blade steel and different handle color, that kind of thing.
So is it a kind of, does that mean it's like a limited edition run? Mm-hmm. They're going to make so many and not run them again? Because otherwise, yes. Wouldn't you just add that to your inventory that it's another model or whatever?
Yeah. Presumably that's a limited number run, and presumably that makes it more collectible.
Gotcha. Okay. All right. Well, let's see if we can make the Knife Junkie happy now. And we talk about Topps knives with two new knives coming out that we're going to talk about, kind of a smaller one and a bigger one.
Well, yeah. Topps just came out with a new knife designed by Greg Powell, who also has been on the show. Great guy. He's their, I believe he's their general manager.
Yeah. Episode number 48, by the way, thenifejunkie.com/48.
Well, he has gotten into, since he's been working at Topps, he's been he's always been an outdoorsman, but he's been focused more on it and been coming out with his own designs. And the first one was a short machete called the Yakare. And that's a very cool, almost barong looking knife. I'm a big fan of the barong. So, you know, he came out with that. So this time he has a new Kiridashi style blade. Kiridashi is a sort of triangular bladed Japanese, traditional Japanese utility knife. Hmm. And he came out with a version of it called the Poker. And it's a 2.5 inch long kind of Warncliffe-y blade. And it's just very chore oriented. It's got a finger ring on the back of it, like a karambit, which could be, which could allow this thing to flex into tactical applications if you're someone who's accustomed to using a karambit for those kind of things. Mm. But, you don't have to be a knife fighter to use a ring at the end of your handle. Ringed daggers are something that have been around for a long time. And they offer everything from easier retraction from the sheath and deployment to if you're doing some sort of utility task and you need that knife in your hand, but you don't necessarily want it protruding from the front of your hand, you can have it dangling from your hand while you're tying that knot, and then you can flip it into your hand and use the knife and then let it dangle again. It's actually a very utilitarian feature, the ring. I mean, the ring was on the original karambits was there for rice harvesters, and that ring was used so that you could do other things with the knife in your hand, but use your have the full dexterity of your hands. So the Poker by Greg Powell. It's a 1095. It's got a kydex sheath. It's 3.6 ounces, and it's just kind of cool looking. And I operate off my eyes,
right?
And
had you at cool with that one?
Yeah, exactly. And Topps came out with another thing, and this knife is kind of on the opposite end of the spectrum. It's a big 12.5 inch bladed, menacing looking kind of kukrioid blade. They're calling it the A Club. So I said kukrioid. It has a big, long, convex blade surface and then sort of a tanto style tip. Both of those edges are sharp. And, you know what? I honestly can't tell if the top, if there's like a third edge, a tertiary edge on the top, like a sharpened swedge. It looks like the field is set up for that, but they probably don't release it like that automatically. Mm. But anyways, this knife was designed by Naked and Afraid's Amanda Kay. Naked and Afraid is a show on Nat Geo or Discovery. Jeez, I can't remember which
one. I can't remember which one either, but I've watched it, a few times.
Where they take self-purported survivalists and drop them somewhere dangerous,
right,
whilst naked, and they usually pair them up, male and female. At least that's the episodes I've seen have been like that.
Right.
And I guess your first thing is to scrimp around and find make a grass skirt, and then but you're always showing off your biceps, so you don't make yourself a shirt. And this woman Amanda Kay, who was on that show, created this knife, and it is. I look at it, and it looks very weapony to me. It's got a super acute pointed tip. It's got this first edge that's about a 3-inch run of flat ground, and then it's got a big convex blade. And we all know that convex shape, like a karambit, like a kukri, is exceptional for chopping, because as your arm moves in the arc, it gathers in material into the final bit of that edge and just, splits it.
Right.
So this thing looks like it could be great as an outdoors knife, and it also looks like it could be great, for fighting off grizzlies.
I wonder if she thought about the design after her appearance on Naked and Afraid.
Oh, no doubt. No doubt. I mean, you don't go through an experience like that with wishy-washy opinions on what you need out of your tools,
Right.
So this is obviously... I'm going to say something cool here. This is obviously forged in the crucible of experience.
That was so cool, I didn't even understand it.
Wasn't that cool? it's also their usual 1095 steel, which I love. And as everyone who uses it outdoors knows, it's super tough, meaning it can absorb a lot of shock. And, that's the difference between super tough and super hard. Super hard keeps its edge forever, but chips out. Super tough keeps coming back after impact. And 1095, I just find pretty agreeable when it comes to sharpening.
Right.
So again, that's the Topps A Club. And if you want to bring your A game, bring your A Club to the wilderness.
What do you think? Oh my gosh. What do you think?
Okay.
We probably ought to end this podcast soon before you run out of puns to keep throwing out.
Should we move on?
Move on. Hey, but Amanda, if you're listening, we'd love to have you on the interview show and talk about this new knife and your experience on Naked Afraid and your knife designing. And anybody out there who's got some new knives or your knife designer, knife maker, want to be featured here on the Knife Junkie Podcast, our Sunday episode, which is our interview show. Just go to thenifejunkie.com/guest. There's a little form there. Just fill out some information, send that in. That goes to Bob, and he works on the schedule, and we can get you on. Love to have you.
And I have to say, before we move on, I have received a number of suggestions, mm-hmm. and I have reached out to those suggestions. Just so you know, this is not falling on deaf ears. I know a couple of times, like just yesterday, I responded to someone who asked a question about selling knives. And he sent this email a couple of weeks ago, and I just have to say it fell off my radar, but I remembered it and I got it and I responded to him. And the same thing with these guest suggestions. I love them. And, I've reached out to these people. I still have one other person that, actually that Alex, suggested, but I have reached out
from Alex's knife box.
From Alex's knife box. And when I hear back from them, I have my own little system, and when I hear back from them, I'll make sure they get on the show.
Well, and speaking of knives for sale, two things there. Bob used Blade Forums to sell some knives, but also put up a YouTube video, which is on the Knife Junkie YouTube channel at thenifejunkie.com/YouTube. We decided to leave that video up there just so that you could see some of the stuff in his collection that's been in his collection. I think what you've sold two of the knives as of recording, but not the lot.
Yeah. Well, from the video, I sold one knife before I put the video up. I put all those on Blade Forums and sold the Hogue on Blade Forums, so that didn't even make it into the video. But yeah, I've done two sales videos, and I'm always thinking, yeah, this is how I'm going to reach people, and it hasn't worked yet. Blade Forums has been the way to go for mm-hmm. me so far, but I'll keep making the videos, and yeah, maybe as we go. Because I figure people know where to find me.
Right.
You know, I put enough stuff out on YouTube now that, you know, everything I put up there is in good shape, or if it's not, it is, I baby all my knives, but everything I put up there, you know, you're actually getting to see the condition of.
Right.
Scuffs and all.
KnifeJunkie.com/YouTube. If you're not a subscriber there, please do subscribe to the Knife Junkie's YouTube channel. That way you don't miss any of his videos, and hit that little bell notification to be notified anytime a new video comes out. And Bob, we have, in a past couple of shows, we've talked about, the movie The Revenant with a great knife fight scene there at the end. We've also talked about the Expendables knife. I think mm-hmm. that was, Darryl Ralph designed knife that was in the Expendables. But it's not an official segment, but kind of one of the things we always wanted to do was talk about knives in movies. And you stayed up again last night watching a movie, and you want to tell us about it.
Okay, so I'll start with the Tom Brown Tracker. Most people know that knife. It's been made by a number of different manufacturers and makers. Tom Brown is a famous tracker, and he designed a famous sort of do-everything-in-the-wilderness knife. And now Topps is... Topps has been making that for a number of years now, and I think it's one of their top sellers, if I'm not mistaken. I think that's what Craig Powell said. And I've always had a problem with this knife, okay? I mean, it, in as much as you can have a problem with a knife. I always thought the design looked like it could do a lot of different stuff, but maybe not excel at any of them. It's kind of got to, well, look it up. I'm not going to even try to describe it, but it has three different distinct cutting surfaces. On the spine, it's got a saw blade, presumably for notching and making traps. And then it's got this big sort of, curved quarter circle, up front that's sharp, that's kind of hatchet-like. And then it's got a more, refined straight edge, leading from that to the handle. Okay. I am no outdoorsman. I kind of wish I were, but I'm not. And, you know, I've chopped enough wood to know what works, but I've never been out in the wilderness, relying on my wits and my tools to survive. Okay, so let that be the caveat to this conversation. I always, like I said, thought the Tom Brown tracker was kind of cool looking, but was maybe more about looks than utility. And then that thought the other night led me to The Hunted, a movie by William Friedkin, the director of The Exorcist. It came out in 2008 with Tommy Lee Jones playing a tracker and Benicio del Toro playing some sort of super top secret special forces guy who specializes in killing with a knife, who's on the lam up
right.
in
the... I remember that movie now. Yeah.
Kind of sounds familiar, right?
Mm-hmm.
Former special forces guy on the lam in the great Northwest woods. Kind of sounds like, well, we won't mention what it sounds like, but good movie, good premise. You know, I'm not going to argue about a knife movie. But the thing that stuck in my craw when I first saw this movie was the knife he uses. He uses a Tom Brown tracker out in the woods to be a badass. And from the start, I was like, Bowie knife. Bowie knife would have been way better. Bowie knife. You know, it's less specialized. You can do more with it because of its relatively neutral formation. You know, on Tom Brown tracker, you got all these different surfaces and all these different edges and all these different, you know, you got a saw here, you got an axe here, you got a knife here. I get the idea, but it just seemed like too much. And then when I saw it in this movie, I'm like, that would make an awful fighting knife. I mean, in as much as a knife can be awful at fighting. And you know what? I could be totally wrong. Never been in a knife fight. Done some training and stuff like that, but never been out there fighting people with knives. So this is all just speculation. But in my fantasy mind while watching this movie, I kept finding myself trying to digitally replace the knife he was using with a knife I wished he was using. But revisiting the movie last night, oh, Jim, I have to say I have a new appreciation for the Tom Brown tracker knife now.
Oh, okay.
I was watching it, and I was watching it maybe with a more mature mind. I mean, the movie came out 12 years ago, or 11 years ago, and now I'm watching it, and I've been through more, and I've experienced more, and I've talked to more people. And now I'm starting to think maybe that actually was a pretty good choice.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, the movie has a lot of unrealistic things, like he takes the knife out of his... sheath and throws it underhand, tosses it kind of like a softball, and it goes like 50 yards and then goes like through a tree, and you can actually see a hole through the tree. I'm like,
right.
Okay.
Pretty
maybe with a Bowie
throw.
Knife. Yeah. Right. Not with a Tom Brown tracker. But actually that the movie kind of sold me on the idea, or it didn't sell me on it, but made me think maybe I should get one of these things in hand and just mess around with it.
Right.
I've been impugning this thing from afar for so long. So maybe I should check it out. So let me just say this. If you're a fan of the Tom Brown tracker knife, watch that movie, The Hunted. It is a pretty good movie. It's not The Exorcist, but it's a pretty good movie. And it's got this Abrahamic theme running through it, like because Tommy Lee Jones, the tracker who's tracking down the off-kilter Benicio del Toro, who's on a killing spree, well, he's the guy who trained Benicio in the first place to be a tracker and a killer. So it's kind of the Abrahamic theme is like the father has to go out and kill the son, basically,
right.
Because God has told him to, God being the CIA in this case, or some mysterious
alphabet agency.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So it's got a good movie theme, and it's got good knife fighting. Some guys from Sayak Kali did all the training. Sayak is a certain school of Kali that interestingly uses lots of knives. They believe in carrying lots of knives, kind of like me. And one of the tactics they use, which you see in this movie played out, which I was appreciated, is before engaging in a knife fight, closing the distance by throwing a knife. Whether or not it sticks in the guy or not is almost immaterial. I mean, of course, you want it to stick in the guy, but you throw it at him. It's distracting. It gives you a second to run and close the distance and start your actual knife fight. They do that a couple of times. Benicio del Toro has some sharpened stakes that he whips at Tommy Lee Jones, adding a little bit of realism. But this knife, this movie also takes the characters through flint knapping. When Tommy Lee Jones finds himself out in the wilderness tracking Benicio del Toro, he has to nap himself a knife out of flint, which is kind of cool, you know.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, in real life, he he would probably just go in with a...
Just
with
go online and buy it.
Have it delivered by drone to his right. particular sector of forest.
In less than a day.
Yeah, exactly. So he... So this is a really good knife movie. You know, if you're looking for a knife movie, definitely check out The Hunted. You probably have, but so while he's flint napping, and Tommy Lee Jones is making his own knife in the field, Benicio del Toro comes across a whole bunch of spring steel and creates a cool fire because, you know, a great fire because he's a survivalist. He creates a forge worthy fire in a second, and he actually forges a knife with some of this spring steel that he finds out in the field. So it's kind of cool. Yeah, probably incredibly unrealistic, but still
just
really cool.
Just happened to find it sitting there.
Yeah, it just happened to be able to forge it in 25 minutes while the helicopters are looming above.
Right.
But man, what a cool movie.
Yeah. Well, if you like the movie, didn't like the movie, if you like the Tom Brown Tracker, you don't like the Tom Brown Tracker, maybe your mind has been changed like the Knife Junkie, give us a call or email and let us know your thoughts on either the movie or the Tom Brown Tracker. You can call the listener line at 724-466-4487, 724-466-4487. And Bob, this show is running a little longer than we had hoped, but I did want to ask you one thing. Would the Tom Brown Tracker, because of its two or three different designs made specifically for certain things, be a desert island knife? As you normally ask your guest on some
God.
Of the interview shows.
Jim, you're blowing my mind. So far, it wouldn't be my desert island knife, but it might make a damn good, you know, because
yeah,
you can
do
a lot
for several different things. Yeah.
Yes. You have that that straight edge you could use as a planing knife, so you could make yourself a raft from raw tree stumps. I have no idea what I'm talking about, but yes, perhaps it would be an excellent desert island knife.
Okay. All right, we're going to leave it at that. If you have any thoughts, again, call the listener line, 724-466-4487, or email Bob at bob@thenifejunkie.com. Let us know. Give us your feedback. We'd love to hear your thoughts on the Knife Junkie Podcast Supplemental Edition, our midweek edition here. So for Bob, the Knife Junkie, DeMarco, I'm Jim, the Knife Newbie Person. Thanks so much for joining us.
Thanks for listening to the Knife Junkie Podcast. If you enjoyed the show, please rate and review at reviewthepodcast.com. For show notes for today's episode, additional resources, and to listen to past episodes, visit our website, theknifejunkie.com. You can also watch our latest videos on YouTube at theknifejunkie.com/YouTube. Check out some great knife photos on theknifejunkie.com/Instagram, and join our Facebook group at theknifejunkie.com/Facebook. And if you have a question or comment, email them to bob@theknifejunkie.com or call our 24/7 listener line at 724-466-4487, and you may hear your comment or question answered on an upcoming episode of the Knife Junkie Podcast.